Greetings, everyone. I'm Dan Murphy, Executive Director of the Masavir Rahmani Center for Business and Government at the Harvard Kennedy School. And I'd like to welcome you to this program on social innovation in Africa with our speaker, Ndidi Nwuneli. And I'm particularly pleased to welcome Ndidi because we're welcoming her back, not just to Harvard, where she received her MBA from HBS, but also to the Masavir Rahmani Center, where she was formerly a senior fellow with us. She is an expert on social innovation, African agriculture and nutrition, entrepreneurship, and youth development. She has over 25 years of international development experience and is a recognized entrepreneur, author, public speaker, consultant, and innovative leader. She has a lengthy and impressive CV. I will just choose a few highlights to mention here to give her full time to give her presentation. She is the Max Bell School of Public Policy's McConnell Visiting Scholar at McGill University. So you can see her work in the academic realm. As an entrepreneur, she is the co-founder of Sahel Consulting, which works in agriculture and nutrition and serves as its managing partner. Through her work at Sahel, she has shaped agricultural strategy and policy and launched innovative business and ecosystem solutions in partnerships with clients in the public and private sectors. She is also the co-founder of AACE Foods, a social enterprise which processes nutritious food made from the best of West Africa's cereals, herbs, pulses, and spices. She is the founder of Leap Africa, which works across Africa, inspiring, empowering, and equipping the next generation of dynamic, principled, and innovative young leaders. She's on many lists, many best of lists. I'll just mention one. She was listed as one of the 20 Power African Women by Forbes. And it, as I said, there are several others there. She is also the author of numerous books, perhaps most relevant, or one that is relevant to today's conversation, is her book, Social Innovation in Africa, A Practical Guide for Scaling Impact. As I mentioned, she has her MBA from HBS and also was a senior fellow at the Masavir Rahmani Center for Business and Government. Before turning the floor over, to Ndidi, I wanted to just take a moment to thank our friends at the Center for African Studies at Harvard University and the Center for International Development at the Harvard Kennedy School for co-sponsoring today's event. The format, first we will hear from Ndidi for a presentation of perhaps 30, 35 minutes. At the conclusion of that, we will turn to the question and answer period, although I'd welcome you to put your questions, queries into the Q&A function throughout the presentation so that we'll have a bank of those to choose from at the conclusion of the event. Let me just say how honored we are to welcome Ndidi back virtually to the Masavir Rahmani Center for Business and Government. And Ndidi, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. It's really a privilege and a pleasure to be here. And I want to thank Daniel for his leadership and his very kind introductions. Thank you, Victoria. Thank you, Claire. I credit the Masavir Rahmani Center for being so pivotal in my life. I spent two rounds there and written two books in 2014, 2015, and I came back in 2019, 2020. And just found a fantastic, warm, supportive home at the center. So thank you again to you and your leadership. I'm gonna share my screen and give a presentation for about 30 minutes on the topic. And then obviously would love to engage in questions. I'm dialing in from Lagos, Nigeria, where I live and work. And I'm gonna start off by just sharing my experiences as a social entrepreneur. The insights I've gained from some of my research, which was also profiled in the book, and some considerations on calls to action. So I am the founder of Leap Africa. Leap stands for Leadership, Effectiveness, Accountability, and Professionalism. I established Leap in 2002, so Leap turns 20 this year, and we work in 8 African countries. I started Leap because I was angry about the state of leadership on the African continent. A lot of young people like myself at the time were being told we're leaders of tomorrow. And I wondered what tomorrow held in a continent where some old men continue to hold on to office in their 70s and 80s. And started an organization to change that narrative, but also to equip young people with the skills and tools to lead. I'm also the co-founder of Sahel, like Danielle mentioned. It's a social enterprise as well. This is a for-profit. Leap is a nonprofit, and we work across Africa, transforming the agriculture and food landscape, focused really on providing advisory services, project implementation, ecosystem solutions, building businesses, and actually launching new initiatives that transform the landscape. Another social enterprise, which is a for-profit, is called AACE Foods. And we started AACE Foods because we really recognize that Africa has some of the best food in the world. We wanted to source from farmers, package for the local market, displace imports, but also address malnutrition. One of our popular foods, and Victoria reminded me that I said, next time I come to Harvard, we have to have some jollof rice. We have the best jollof rice from West Africa, and this is one of our proud spices from AACE Foods. Then I launched Nourishing Africa, which has both a for-profit and non-profit arm, incorporated as a hybrid organization. And our mission is to drive the profitable and sustainable growth of the African food landscape by equipping, supporting, and celebrating over a million entrepreneurs in the ecosystem. It's like a Facebook, DevEx, and LinkedIn for entrepreneurs in the food and agriculture sector, really focused on helping them thrive and grow, and it's all digital. So we have a members hub, a knowledge and capacity building framework, funding portal, et cetera. And I'm mentioning this for those of you who are interested in getting funding for your social enterprises in Africa. Nourishing Africa has a free funding portal for you. So please check it out. And then my latest venture, which has both a for-profit and non-profit as well, is called Changing Narratives Africa. And this is really focused on changing the way the rest of the world views Africa using food as a bridge. I look at what the Japanese food has done for Japan, Thai food has done for Thailand, and I really believe that 54 countries in Africa have such amazing food that the rest of the world does not know about, does not appreciate or recognize. And through Changing Narratives Africa, we're amplifying the stories about how we've contributed to the global food ecosystem. We're also getting our food products on global shelves, and we're connecting entrepreneurs across the board. So you can see that I'm a serial social entrepreneur. These are the ones I've started. I have a few more that I didn't include here, like NIA, which is focused on women. And I've helped start about 20 other social enterprises. So through all these experiences, what has motivated me? So when you look at this picture, what do you see? Some people see heads of people, thousands of people, right? You think about Africa in 1980, the African continent had 477 million people. 2016, 1.2 billion. By 2050, we're going to be 2.4 billion on the African continent. Nigeria, where it sits, is going to have 450 million people. And Lagos, the city, is going to have 50 million people. Now, from a social enterprise lens, those are people who need housing, water, education, healthcare, sanitation, you know, the environment has to be sorted out. So you see these people and you see opportunity if you're a social enterprise, right? Or a social entrepreneur because you're a problem solver. And I have been very focused on saying, how can all the initiatives I've started scale? How can we reach millions? Because we're designing to reach millions. And how can we work ourselves out of jobs? So let's get to the basics. Social innovation and social enterprise are often confused as terminologies. And when I first came to Harvard in my early 20s, you know, the social enterprise initiative was just taking roots. But a social innovator or social innovation is a novel solution to a social problem where the value created accrues primarily to society. And you can be a social innovator in the public sector, in the private sector, in civil society. Now, if you decide to launch that initiative into a standalone company, then it's called a social enterprise, right? With an innovation that is solving a problem. And that innovation can be a product, a process, a technology, a way of thinking, a piece of legislation, an idea, a movement. And oftentimes we think, oh, it has to be completely new, but it can be a tweak to an existing solution. It doesn't have to be a completely new idea. It can be a new approach to solving an old problem. in a more efficient, effective, and sustainable way. And we all know what social problems are, where the majority of the benefit, though, accrues to society or disadvantaged groups, not necessarily shareholder value, right? And that's really what we're defining as a social enterprise, a social innovation. And for me, from the beginning, my focus has been on scaling, because I really strongly believe we can't set up initiatives to reach hundreds of people or thousands of people if we have problems that affect millions. And when I came to the Kennedy School, my focus was really on defining what scaling was and looking at what it would take for the social enterprises I had started to scale. And I really found out that there are so many ways to scale, from replication, adaptation, to scaling ideas, to scaling through marketing dissemination, to scaling through a thought process where everybody accepts the thinking. But the first finding was that, you know, this sector is still evolving. And through the research that I did in the year I spent there, you know, learned that clearly there are serious data gaps that affect the work that we do as social entrepreneurs. So I created an online survey tool. I talked to over 80 social innovators who are scaling. I talked to funders. I talked to, you know, all sorts of industry leaders in the social enterprise landscape. And the first key finding was that not every social innovation should be scaled or is scalable. As a social entrepreneur, your first decision is, are you going to create a state-of-the-art model, a center of excellence, or are you going to start an initiative that reaches millions? Obviously, I'm more wedded to the millions components and the need to scale. But there are a few social innovators, and one of them is my friend Patrick Awa, who started Ashesi University in Ghana. And he said, you know what? I want to be a center of excellence. Let other people come, learn from me and replicate it. But I'm not interested in having, you know, 1,000 universities across Africa. You contrast that to, you know, Fred Swanika, who says, I want, you know, hundreds of universities across Africa as a way to scale African Leadership University. So that's a different model. Jacaranda is another example. Lagos Business School says we're the oasis of sanity. We're a center of excellence. We're going to replicate through the people who pass through our doors, but we're not going to have an institution that reaches millions. Obviously, technology is changing that, because now with technology, they can have online education. But in terms of their physical offering, their core offering, they've chosen not to scale. The second is really the prerequisites for social innovations that scale and that reach millions and that have impact. And this is, you know, classic, that every social enterprise that has scale, that has impact, has to have a clear mission, clear values, a clear structure, clear pathways to scale, a clear business model, the right talent and leadership, the right financing, the right partnerships, and the right vision and theory of change. And I love this quote by Nelson Mandela, which says, vision without action is just a dream. Action without vision just passes the time. And vision and action can change the world. So it's one thing to say, I want to solve this problem. This is how I'm going to solve it. But if you don't act on it in partnership with others, with the right financing, the right team, the right business model, you will fail, even if you have a good heart that wants to solve a problem. And a classic example, which I profiled in my book, is the play pump. And I don't know how many of you have heard of the play pump. I'm sure some of the students on this call are much younger. But in 2006, I went to the World Economic Forum, and the play pump was celebrated as the greatest solution to solve water challenges in Africa. And the idea was that children would play around the merry-go-round, and it would fill this water reservoir, and then the woman wouldn't have to work for 2 hours to fetch water. But as they tried to scale, they realized that children had to play for 23 hours to fill the water tank. If children have to play for 23 hours, it's no longer play, it's work, right? They also found out that when the play pump broke, it cost too much to fix. The average play pump cost $10,000. An average borehole in my local community cost $3,000. Many of us have designed play pumps in the social enterprise landscape. Very nice on paper, celebrated. I mean, when this was announced, you know, Stephen Case, you know, funded it. Laura Bush was the first lady at the time, endorsed it, but it was not scalable. It was a failed social innovation. Now, the question is, as we think about the problems we try to solve in our society, what products or services are best suited to address those problems? And can those interventions actually scale? Are they demand-driven and can they scale? And so through this book, I came up with six components of business models that are social innovations that scale. First, they have to be demand-driven. And oftentimes we think we know what communities need, and we don't. And we see this all the time in agriculture. We see this in every single ecosystem, right? You say, oh, I think there's a problem. These people need this. Well, that's not what they need. In agriculture, we've tried to scale orange flesh sweet potato. I don't know how many of you have heard of orange flesh sweet potato or orange flesh cassava. And communities are like, no, we like our white sweet potato. We like, I know orange flesh sweet potato has vitamin A. So it's supposed to solve all the, you know, iodine and vitamin A deficiencies in many communities, but we're not going to buy it. We don't prioritize it. And regardless of how much money you put against it and how many ways you teach communities how to make alternative foods, they're not interested. It has to be demand driven. There has to be measurable impact, not just in terms of one life, but in terms of a prolonged change in the lives of the people who are benefiting. The business model has to be simple, and you have to be able to explain it, not just to your staff, but to your beneficiaries. You have to engage the community. It has to leverage technology, and it has to be low cost. And I think the play pump example is an example of a very costly intervention, but many of our interventions are very costly, and that really affects how many people we can reach. So I tweaked this idea a few years later when I came back to the Kennedy School and looked at this model again. And you'll see a few additions. So it's demand-driven with measurable value addition. So I've combined the measurement and evaluation with the demand, because that's the only way to test whether something is demand-driven. Leverages technology, but it also leverages data and innovation, right? We have to leverage data, even as social entrepreneurs, because data tells us whether we're making a difference, whether that difference is sustainable, and how we're changing the lives of people that we work with. Three, it has to shape the shape the ecosystem. Before I said shape the community, engage the community. In this time, it's really shaping the ecosystem, changing the policies that undergird the problems in the first place. It has to be cost efficient with dynamic systems and structures. It has to be simple with compelling branding. And one of the biggest gaps I realized is many social entrepreneurs don't know how to sell their stories. And the ones that are celebrated, that we all hear about, are the ones who are so good about telling their stories. And all of us should learn how to tell our stories and amplify our voice. And then I added another dimension, which is that every intervention has to adapt to climate change, has to be agile, has to have resilience embedded in its DNA so that it can adapt to risks and shocks. Now, there are lots of exciting models emerging in our ecosystem, leveraging technology on the African continent. And I have two examples here, which I'm sure you've heard of, Cow Tribe and Twiga. And Cow Tribe is a social enterprise in Ghana. And they're trying to solve the problem of a livestock that require vet care. And we all know that across rural communities, not just in Ghana, but even in the United States, we have livestock, we have a few number of vet doctors, and how do you link them up? Historically, you'd pick up your phone and call a vet doctor and say, can you come over? My cow is about to give birth, or I need to give immunization. So basically what they're doing is using cell phones to connect vet doctors and farmers, and using technology to ensure that you schedule the vet care and, you know, the vaccinations and all through the life cycle of the animal. And that is amazing, right? We always knew that existed, but how can we leverage technology to provide this to thousands of farmers? Twiga is another social enterprise that has generated so much interest and raised a lot of money. It's a for-profit, and Twiga basically connects rural farmers with roadside sellers of fruits and vegetables in Kenya. And this is another example where a roadside seller of a fruit and vegetable ordinarily would wake up at 4 a.m. to go to the market to buy fresh fruits and display them. Now on their cell phone, they can order within 14 hours. The fresh produce comes from the farm to the city, and it's fresher. You cut out the middleman, more income for the roadside seller, more income for the farmer, and it's a win-win. And so those are examples of models where we're seeing a lot of new models that leverage innovation and technology. Beyond the business model, for scaling. Talent is critical. And I realize this for every social enterprise that I've started, is that if I don't build my capacity as a leader, I don't constitute a strong board of directors, and I don't attract mission-driven high achievers from the beginning, my idea is dead on the water, because there's so much you can only do by yourself. You have to empower others to join you. I just mentioned my latest social enterprise, Changing Narratives Africa. And, you know, started the organization last year, incorporated it, put it together an advisory board, and haven't raised any money to date, right? So how have I been able to do everything we've done through Changing Narratives Africa? Volunteers. And that people were calling me. The minute I put on LinkedIn, I'm starting a new social enterprise, there's a gap, there's a need, I'm angry. I got 150 comments. I got phone calls from all sorts of people. How can we support this? We want to get involved. And that's really, how do you leverage talent to get your ideas scaled? And now, just this month, we've gotten three funders come through to say they want to support the initiative. But from June to today, if I didn't have these volunteers, we wouldn't have been able to do anything. And funders are coming through because they can see some traction. And that's really important, right? I could have sat on the idea for a while, but I had to get it going. So attracting mission-driven high achievers, outsourcing where you can, and then structuring your human resources for scaling and building a culture of innovation and excellence is critical and something we take for granted. I talked about telling our stories. And I think many of us don't tell our stories because there's so many great social entrepreneurs on the African continent. Through Leap Africa, we have a social innovators program. So we actually select 50 social entrepreneurs every year. We're telling them and teaching them how to amplify their voice and tell their story through their online presence, through their brand promise, through their marketing strategy. And one example I love is Hello Tractor. And some of you might know this social entrepreneur. And he has a company that is called the Uber of Tractor, basically using software to connect farmers to tractor providers. And when I interviewed him for my last book, he said, Ndidi, I actually learned how to market. I learned how to communicate. And every day I listen to the CEOs of the major companies, the tractor companies in the world. I listen to the earning reports. I listen to what keeps them up at night so that when I meet them, I can talk their language. And he's gotten them to profile him in every major magazine in the world. He's used very creative strategies to amplify his voice and to generate interest and funding in his work. Financing is another gap that a lot of social innovators face on the African continent, but what we're learning is that there's more money available for social innovators than there are social innovators willing to be positioned for that money. And this mismatch and this gap often occurs because we don't know where the funding is. We're not well positioned to receive it. We don't have the credibility, the strong financial systems and structures, and we don't know how to position ourselves. So the same people keep on getting the funding. And there's so many ecosystems that are emerging, so many accelerators and incubators, and these create so much excitement in my mind. Shaping the ecosystem is another key component of social innovation. In every ecosystem, there are policies that affect the work we're doing, the problems we're trying to solve. They're enablers, they're beneficiaries, they're opponents, they're competitors, and they're bystanders. The question is, how do we position ourselves to take advantage of the opportunities, but also to prepare ourselves for the challenges? And I would give you a few examples of two companies two social innovators that I really admire. One organization very early in my career that I got exposed to was Action Health Incorporated. And they had a couple, the wife was a journalist, the husband was a doctor, had come up with this idea that they had to promote sexuality education in schools. There were high rates of teenage pregnancies, et cetera. And they started with clubs in schools and they tried to scale to get the curriculum adopted by public schools in Nigeria. And guess who their biggest opponents were? Can you type in the chat who you think their biggest opponents were as they tried to scale sexuality education in schools? Anybody guess? I'm not getting any responses in the chat box. One of their biggest challenges were actually from Christian mothers. And the Christian mother happens to be the director of the Ministry of Education in Lagos State. So having to turn her from an opponent who says, you're trying to teach sexuality education to children, you want to corrupt them, to thinking sexuality education is actually really useful because it's preventative. If they learn about their bodies and they learn how to say no, and they learn about the challenges with, you know, STDs, or the boys learn about, you know, boundaries, and the girls learn about boundaries and their voice, that prevents a lot of this. So having to channel all the energy to changing policy, but also to getting their biggest opponents to become their biggest supporters, proved to be a 10-year struggle. And today the curriculum is adopted across Nigeria for public schools. Now the challenge for us is, how do we get it into private schools? Right? And the second, which is highly celebrated, is M-PESA. And a lot of you know M-PESA. M-PESA has transformed the ecosystem in Kenya. What started as a very informal way, people using cell phone credits to transfer money to their relatives in rural communities, has become the biggest mobile money system now in East Africa, and has been replicated across the world. And what was so critical to M-PESA's success and impact was the ability of those who caught onto this idea, Safaricom, and the funders to shape policy, to ensure that the ecosystem was not challenged or threatened, banks weren't threatened, you know, to shape policy to enable the emergence of an M-PESA was critical. And there are many other approaches to scaling the education sector, through replication, through finance franchise models, to transforming ecosystems. And when we think about some of these examples, Leap Africa is trying to scale now in its 20th year by actually having an online leadership institute to enable us to reach many more people. So as I round up, I want to talk about a call to action, because I always believe that it's important to get people to think about what role they can play in promoting social innovation in Africa. And there are five that I've outlined here. The first is that we have to prioritize local organizations in the African continent. This is something I believe very strongly. And what do I mean by that? If you look at many of the awards for social innovation across the world, SCOL, Echoing Green, Schwab, when you look at those who get these awards, and of course it's getting better, many of the people who get these awards for Africa are not indigenous Africans, don't live in Africa, might have gone to Harvard Business School or Harvard Kennedy School, come up with a great idea to solve a problem in Africa, and are going to Africa to solve it. And while we welcome that as Africans, it's really important to also ensure that you don't crowd out local organizations that might already be trying to solve those problems you're coming in to solve. We also have to revamp funding streams, and this is really important. We have to ensure diversity, that people of color and from communities serve on the boards of the organizations we've started. We have to change mindsets about Africa, and we have to partner and collaborate. And I'll just delve into this. When we've looked at funding flows into Africa, of the $9 billion that was channeled to Africa between 2011 and 2015, only 6% went to local organizations. 6%. For me, that is dismal, right? Dismal. If you look at $1.1 billion spent by the US, UK, and Canada on malaria development in 2017, only 1% went to local organizations, 1%. We have to transform this. We have to change this paradigm. And I'm working with a coalition of others to push for this, to change this, to ensure that we prioritize local organizations, which means you have to measure and track what percentage of local organizations are getting the funding, and how you determine who gets funding and what the requirements are. The second call to action is that every social innovator really has to come to solving problems with a private sector lens. I work in the agriculture sector, as you know, and I realize that if we come with a social enterprise lens where we're trying to help people, it's useful, but ultimately it has to make business sense for it to be sustained beyond donor funding. And so how do you get private sector involved in solving that problem? How do you ensure that no one is left behind? And how do you ensure that we don't take advantage of fads like greenwashing and nutrition washing, that we actually embed what we're trying to solve into the ethos of the community? How do we ensure that we have women and youth at the forefront? Equity is critical. Equity is critical. They have to be visible and critical players. We have to ensure that they're early adopters already. We have to ensure that we remove bias and discrimination and give voices and agency to all actors. And I'll round up with some of my favorite quotes. One of them is a Tibetan quote which says, if I tell you my dream, you might forget it. If I act on my dream, perhaps you'll remember it. But if I involve you, it becomes your dream too. This is the only way social innovators can ensure that their organizations make impacts but outlive them. Involve other people in your dream. Don't just tell them about your dream. Don't just act on it alone. Involve them in your dream. And I'll tell you that I've gotten so much traction in the last few months from my latest social innovation, Changing Narratives Africa. We launched a Narrative Changer Food Fellowship in August last year. And we've selected 8 entrepreneurs who are getting their food on global shelves. And I'm so proud to announce that some of the leading retailers in the United States have agreed to create small African aisles for our food products, high quality, healthy packaged food from Africa. And this social enterprise is really focused on doing that, changing narratives. And we have also created media because we realize we have to actively influence media. And I'm inviting many of you to join me. If you have connections, I'd love to get some of these podcasts on NPR, on all the radio stations across the United States. One is called, our first podcast is called Crazy for Coffee, Embrace Its Roots. We all love coffee, but most people don't know the birthplace of coffee was in Africa. Most people don't know 18 countries in Africa grow some of the best coffee in the world. And that we just don't export commodities. We actually have very high quality processed coffee. We all love chocolates, but most of us don't know that 70% of the world's cocoa comes from Africa and that we have some of the best chocolatiers in the world on the African continent. And many of us love Coca-Cola, but we don't realize that Coca-Cola was created with cola nuts from West Africa, probably from Nigeria. So if you have coffee or cocoa today, or even Coca-Cola, you have Africa to thank for it. And we're starting to change those narratives. And our vision for Changing Narratives Africa is that Nigerian jollof will become more popular than Japanese sushi. Senegalese foyo will displace quinoa. Ethiopian teff will displace white flour. And we're starting to change those narratives because we believe this is critical. So this is the new face of Africa, right? A healthy child, a happy child, a child who goes on to live their highest potential, not the face that got me started on this walk, which is the face of poverty being affiliated with Africa. And then my favorite quote, if you want to go fast, go alone. A social entrepreneur cannot go alone, right? If you want to go far, you have to go with others. And if we want to go fast and far, which we need to on the African continent, we have to leave our egos and logos behind, and we have to work with humility, integrity, and excellence, focused on a shared vision and shared goals. So I look forward to taking your questions, and thank you so much for listening.
Thank you, Ndidi. That was an excellent presentation, an amazing range of things that you have been involved with, initiatives that you have led, and lessons you have to share. I want to start with a question. There are many students at the Kennedy School who aspire to become a social entrepreneur, but are maybe intimidated by the landscape and by just getting started, taking that first step. What advice for someone like yourself who's been involved in so many of these operations, what advice might you offer a student or one of our audience members who is interested in doing this, but perhaps feels they don't know where to get started or feel a bit intimidated? How might you guide that person?
Thank you, Daniel. So there are a couple of steps. The first one is you have to determine if you are ready mentally, emotionally, physically, to start a new organization, or whether you think you should gain experience by working in an established social enterprise first. And I always tell people, it doesn't hurt sometimes to get experience working with someone else, to learn from their mistakes, but also to build your confidence and your capacity. Now, if you feel like you're ready, you have an idea, it's burning within you, and you feel a strong urge to launch it, the first step, which I always take with every social enterprise, is to write down your idea, right? Then test out that idea with a few trusted advisors. I write down an idea, I send it to a few trusted people, I say, what do you think? Do you think there's a gap here? Are there other organizations that are already doing this? Because you don't need to reinvent the wheel. And then reach out to a few other organizations who might be doing something similar to test out whether you really have a unique value proposition. The third step, if you have proven that you have a unique value proposition, you are mentally ready, physically ready, emotionally ready, is to see whether there's an accelerator, incubator that will accept you because of how good your idea is. I always think it helps to have a little bit of funding and to have handholding. And right now there are so many accelerators and incubators ready, willing to accept and support you. And if you enroll in one of them, then you get a lot of handholding. But if you can't enroll in one of them or you feel like you're ready, there's so many funders who are willing to support startups in the social enterprise, especially if you can constitute a strong board of directors and have a very clear plan for execution. And my book, which I wrote at the Massava River, is a step-by-step book. It's like a textbook how-to with case studies, with questions, with call-out boxes. And it's very, very practical. So I'll suggest you get the book. And at the end of the book, I have about 20 pages of all the fellowships and programs and incubators, accelerators available to you. There's Draper Richards Kaplan, there's Ashoka. There are lots of incubators and accelerators that would actually fund you for the first 3 years while you set this up and will pay your salary. Echoing Green is a great one. And so the long list of those fellowships are available to you. And as I always say, start off with a pilot. I don't believe in launching full-fledged national initiatives, you know, international initiatives. Start off with a pilot because then you can tweak and test your model. The data that comes from that pilot allows you to change and modify, measure, be honest about what's working and what needs to change. And then attract mission-driven high achievers from the beginning, people who share your vision and who are willing to help you succeed. And I walk through all of that in my book, so I highly encourage you to get a copy if you can.
Wonderful. One of the things you mentioned was being emotionally ready. And one thing we know about entrepreneurship is it involves a lot of failure. Even someone like yourself, who's experienced tremendous success, has certainly experienced a situation where you've tried to start something. You mentioned the play pump scenario, which people thought would be a good idea and later failed. I'm assuming when you're talking about being emotionally prepared, it's also the resiliency to deal with both small and big failures. And I wonder if you might, I think that's one thing that students tell me holds them back a bit. Can you talk a little bit about when experiencing failure, how you deal with it in these, in how you learn from it? In the play pump scenario, did people who were involved in that learn the lesson that needed to be learned and move on to something that was better? It would be great if you could speak a little bit about that, Ndidi. Thank you.
Yes. So the truth is that we're lifelong learners. Like, we continue to reinvent ourselves and learn from our mistakes. But resilience in the social enterprise landscape is even more important because many of us come to this with our hearts. We feel something that's tugging at us to solve a problem. We want to improve the lives of others. And so you bring your whole self to this. And when it fails, you take it as a personal, very personal journey. And it really is demoralizing. But I would say that for me, there are a couple of steps. I can't do anything by myself. I'm a strong Christian, so my faith is my anchor. And I feel like the source of my strength is my relationship with God. And that has been so important to renew me on a daily basis. But then the second thing is, you have to be someone who doesn't take things personally. You are here to serve, you're here to improve the lives of others, and you have to be someone who's a giver without expecting much in return. And usually it's not the people who you give who say thank you, it's others. So that ability to kind of guard your heart is really important. But then it's important to form partnerships because it reduces the risk. Working with others, you share the load, but you share the risk. I would say for me, I've recently experienced a huge setback with one of the organizations I started, and it was really tough, really, really tough. It's still evolving, so I can't share the full story, but it was a very clear example of where the lack of systems and structures exposes you to risks, and where you entrust others with a big responsibility and they default, and your whole credibility is on the line. The good thing is when you're starting, you don't have the large credibility problem as I do when you're 25 years in, but it's something to be careful about.
Ndidi, I want to turn to our audience Q&A. I would encourage people to keep putting their questions in there. We have quite a few. One is someone has asked, do you have recommendations on where to find collaborators and co-founders for new social enterprises in Africa? And I want to supplement that question, if I may, by also saying, what recommendations do you have for not just identifying who they might be, but for going through that process? What are the right steps to take to come out on the other side with a strong partner who's going to help you be successful?
Well, for those of you who are in school, some of your best partners are right there in your classes. You know, work groups, your study groups, your case projects, you kind of test out people who share your values and who have your work ethic. And some of my best friends and partners and board members have been people I met through school. Beyond school, I really believe the good matchmaking that happens in some of the countries that we belong to are in the social enterprise organizations. I've mentioned like the Ashokas of the world. There are a few really committed funders who can also help you find the right partners. In the African context right now, some of the most innovative funders, the MasterCard Foundation, the Ford Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, are very good at helping you find partners. The local philanthropic networks also, I serve on the board of the Africa Philanthropy Forum. We're very good. We're actually starting a matchmaking kind of initiative. And for a global movement, and I see some people here from Azerbaijan, please check out Catalyst 2030. Catalyst 2030 was created by a friend of mine called Jeroen. She's actually Indian, and she has started about 20 social enterprises. But she brought together Echoing Green, Schwab Foundation, and the Skoll Foundation, and all the social entrepreneurs in the three networks together into something called Catalyst 2030. It's open to everybody to join. If you go on the Catalyst 2030 website, you see, you can search by sector, you can search by country or region, and you will find other people who share your interest in your region or country. And there's a lot of networking, a lot of information sharing, and a lot of support. So I highly recommend that you check out Catalyst 2030 as a good place to find like-minded individuals. But if you're finding partners, I'll say look for three things. One is values. You need people who share your values, values of integrity, hard work, ethics, you know, commitment to excellence, whatever it is. The second is you need people who are complementary to you, right? So I've partnered with a few people. I bring X, they bring Y. We have to complement each other. If we're extremely identical in what we offer, then we don't need to be in a partnership. So I have a partnership with my husband. We started the AACE Foods together. He has a finance, operations background. I have a strategy, marketing, HR. So we've divided up the work. We complement each other. It makes sense, right? But we, even though we're married, we documented our partnership. We documented everything, our ownership, our responsibilities, because we find that you take it for granted if you don't document it. And at the end of the day, it doesn't matter how good a friend you are or how strong your marriage is, anything can happen. So make sure that you don't take anything for granted. You're complimentary and you document. And then do your due diligence, please. Do your due diligence on the other person. Test them out with a pilot. Test them out with a short-term engagement. See whether you can work with them, whether you want to spend a lot of time in their presence. And if they're red flags, please run for the hills. I love a quote by Maya Angelou, which says, if someone who shows you who they are, believe them the first time. If someone shows you who they are, believe them the first time. Please run for the hills if you see any red flags.
And Didi, you referenced our colleague attending from Azerbaijan. And that person is asking, number one, how to stay up to date on your work. Is that via Twitter or another means that you might offer people to stay in touch with what you're doing? And also a question around how to learn about best practices, whether it be from yourself or from others. Are there, how should someone who is, this particular person is at a government agency, how should someone who's interested in learning more about this help, how should they help educate themselves about best practices in the field of social entrepreneurship?
Yes, great questions. First, I would love to stay in touch. Twitter, Instagram, LinkedIn, I'm active in all three. I believe in forming partnerships across the world. You know, when I started Leap, I found organizations right there in Boston, in New York, in that were doing exactly or similar things. I wrote them and I said, I'd like your organization to be my organization's mentor. Can we have staff exchanges? Can we share knowledge? I want to be the best in the world. I want to stay connected to those who are the best in the world. You owe it to yourself to do that. And definitely check out in every context, which organization. So actually in your context, there are two organizations I'll refer you to. One is called CIP. I think it's Center for Public Enterprise, which is a CIPE, which is a great group in Washington, DC that really helps with changing policies, judiciary, et cetera. Great resource, great networks. And they have a lot of funding to help with policy formulations, especially in emerging economies. So build a database of organizations similar to SAPE that can support you along the journey. And as I've evolved, I've worked in youth development, I've worked in gender, I work in agriculture now. I find the organizations that have data and I sign up for their networks and their mailing lists. And on a daily basis, I receive the information I need to stay current, but I also join groups. And as you increase your visibility, please write op-eds. I'm a big believer in op-eds. I write op-eds. I've gotten some training from Aspen. They have a New Voices Fellowship, which I highly recommend to all of you, that helps you build your ability to write. But as you write, people also listen and it increases your profile. Then they invite you to join initiatives, which then allow you to learn from others, but also amplify your ideas and voices.
And Ndidi, we have an audience member writing in from South Africa wanting to know if you do any work there. And if you do, it'd be great to hear about that. And if not, do you perhaps have recommendations for those attendees from South Africa of organizations or people they may look into or connect with who are there?
Yeah, so we actually work in South Africa through Nourishing Africa and Changing Narratives Africa. So please get on our websites, those two websites, I'll type them in and check out the resources available to you in South Africa. And in terms of South Africa has an amazing and growing group of social entrepreneurs. And I really believe this is a good time to be a social entrepreneur in South Africa. Depending on what your passions are, for example, if your passion is in gender, the Grassa Michelle Trust is fantastic. I've mentioned the Africa Leadership Community, Africa Leadership University, Africa Leadership Academy. But beyond that, there are lots of different initiatives that the Africa Leadership Initiative, I'm part of that as well. That's out of South Africa, the Desmond Tutu Leaders Program. So there are lots of networks that have a lot of resources and support for you. In terms of funders, lots of great funders focused on South Africa. And I'm fortunate to be part of the Africa Philanthropy Forum, which I mentioned. And we have great emerging philanthropists from Africa, from South Africa, who are supporting local nonprofits and social enterprises in South Africa, like the Masiwas, the Motsepes, and the list is growing. And that's what's exciting about Africa, is that we're not just dependent on the rest of the world to support our local social enterprises. There are lots of social entrepreneurs who can get funding locally as well.
And Ndidi, we will take what you put in the chat and we will email it to all of the registrants, as we email everyone after every program with the link to the YouTube video of this. So we'll be sure to include those that information and any other resources you want to share with people when we do that. There was somebody who wrote in about degradation of soil, and if that is a topic that you've worked on. And I just wonder, again, I think a lot of people are asking questions really about networking and finding resources. So for the audience member who asked that question, for someone who's interested in social entrepreneurship having to do with soil health, what would you, you know, how would you guide them to move forward on that issue, either to start their own social enterprise or to find resources that could be of assistance to them?
Yeah, so soil health is definitely a huge issue, not just in Africa, across the world. I sit on the board of AGRA, the Alliance for Green Revolution, and we have done a lot in soil health. So I would ask you to please check out the AGRA board website. I'm going to put in the link. And definitely reach out if there's any way that I can connect you with those who can help you with this. AGRA is, as I mentioned, the Alliance for Green Revolution, has been working on soil health for over 20 years. Leveraging a lot of innovation. There's also the African International Institute for Tropical Agriculture. It's not just in Africa, it's all over the world, IITA. It's one of the CGIS centers that works in soil health as well. I'll put in the link to their website. And then beyond IITA and AGRA, if you're working in India, there are similar research institutes through the CGIR network in India. So I don't know what country you're in or what part of the world, but happy to connect you with other resources depending on where you are.
Wonderful, thank you. I wanted to follow up on changing narratives Africa. You shared with us about this relatively new initiative. And can you, in your presentation, can you say a bit more about the narratives that you seek to change and what you Yes. hope they will be going forward?
Yes, thank you. So as many of you know, when you think about Africa in the West, when people say, you know, I'm African, most people think of poverty. They associate the face of Africa with a hungry child. I remember coming to the US at 16, I was telling Daniel that I started off my journey in upstate New York. And people would tell me, oh, my mom used to say, finish your dinner. There are starving children in Africa. There are starving children in Ethiopia and Eritrea and Biafra. And I was so angry because I grew up in southeastern Nigeria. I hadn't seen the starving child that people were talking about. That was not part of my reality or identity. And it made me angry because it also affected the way people would view us, view me in terms of what I could accomplish. And the more I've learned about the food ecosystem, the more I learn about Africa, the more I realize we have some of the best food in the world. But when you look at global rankings of food, and all the 54 countries are grouped as one, and African food is ranked extremely low. There's complete ignorance about food from Africa. Some people have eaten Ethiopian food. A few people have eaten maybe once or twice food from another part of the continent, maybe Moroccan food, but very little awareness and appreciation of the food from our continent. And we have some of the best food in the world, hands down, right? But most of the people in the world don't know. So the more I've learned, the more I realized that countries like Japan were very strategic in using their food as a way to build bridges, as a way to build appreciation, as a way to build connections. It didn't happen by chance that sushi is now one of the most popular food in the world and that Japanese food ranks number one in the world. It is not by chance, right? Japan is quite far away. Many people have never been there, but we all love sushi. And so it was very strategic, very deliberate, very systematic, and it was a concerted effort. You've seen that with Got Milk. That was a campaign to promote milk consumption, right? You've seen that with many other types of food. And so what we're doing at Changing Narratives is, number one, using media to build awareness and appreciation. But number two, we're actually getting our products on shelves. We're helping some of the best entrepreneurs from our continent increase their branding, improve their traceability, meet global standards, and get on shelves. And thankfully, I had a phenomenal conversation with a global CEO of one of the largest retail companies in the world, and he's committed to creating a part of his store devoted to African food. So I'm excited. Watch this space, and I'm looking for more partners. Look forward to working with as many of you as possible who are committed and interested in changing narratives.
Thank you, Ndidi. I think we have time for just one more question. I wanted to follow up on the question about changing narratives. It seems like one of the things that, one of the many things that you do really well is marketing and communicating. And you mentioned the importance of narratives, the importance of personal voice, the importance of what I interpreted as personal brand building and brand building for your enterprises. How do you get started with that on a shoestring, where many social enterprises will start off on a shoestring? So you're 25 years in, but for that person in year one, how should they be marketing themselves and their enterprise?
Well, I'll tell you that if you're still in school, definitely you should join clubs. I think being a president of the African Students Association, starting the Africa Business Conference at Harvard, it helped me build my muscle as to communicating, build my confidence, and start building relationships. The second is now you have social media. We didn't have social media at the time. You can leverage social media to share your ideas in a respectful way, but also to connect with others who share your ideas. And then all of us have the ability to write and speak. But we also have the ability to support others, and finding good mentors, finding good helps. You know, two of my biggest mentors are my professors from Harvard Business School, Deborah Spahr and Linda Hill. And I met them in first year and they took me under their wing, and I've stayed in touch with them all these years. Please build those relationships with your former bosses, your former teachers from high school, from university. Stay in contact with people as you grow. They serve as sources of encouragement, advice. They serve as your biggest champions and critics. And they also help you amplify your voice. And this is, for me, critical. So Daniel, these are just a few tips. And thank you so much for this opportunity. It's really been a joy engaging with you all.
Well, and Ndidi, I just want to say, I think we've seen during this presentation your experience and your work as a social innovator, as an entrepreneur in the academic realm, as an author, and it's been an incredibly enriching discussion. And I just want to say how happy and proud we are to have you as part of the MRCBG family. And we look forward, of course, to engaging with you for many years to come. And as I mentioned, we will be sending out a link to this video and also some of the resources that Ndidi mentioned in her talk to everyone who registered. But Ndidi, let me thank you on behalf of all of our attendees and on behalf of MRCBG for being our guest today. It was a wonderful conversation. Thank you, and thank you to all of our attendees.
Thank you again, and enjoy the rest of your day. Take good care.